Thank you for making it possible for me to be here. All right, we're going. So yes, I've been asked to talk about the challenges of publishing open access journals in the humanities and to talk about the experience of Open Humanities Press in particular. And I'm going to start with focusing on OHP just to set the stage for some of the broader comments that I'm going to make in relation to open access publishing in the humanities. It's going to pick up on the theme of experimenting that John Wilinski ended with last night. Although I want to raise some questions for his idea that the point of doing so is that we can build on and share the work of others in an efficient manner. I'm going to come back to that in a little while. So Open Humanities Press was founded by Siggy Jokkan, David Ottina and Paul Ashton and myself. It's the first open access publishing house explicitly dedicated to critical and cultural theory. And it was launched in 2008 by an international group of scholars in response to the perceived crisis whereby academic publishers in the area have cut back on the number of research led titles they bring out in order to focus on readers and introductions and textbooks and reference works. And libraries are finding it difficult to afford the research that is published, both books and journals. So in that respect, OHP's mission is, you know, it's a simple one. It's to make leading works of critical and cultural thought freely and permanently available on a worldwide basis by publishing them open access. No problem. So, in the first instance, OHP consists of a collective of already existing, high-quality, independent, as I've learned to call them, scholar-published journals. And the initial idea was to establish a name and reputation for OHP with its journals before tackling the more difficult problem of publishing book-length open access material. Difficult because of issues of economics and prestige that I'll come on to in a moment. However, things have developed much faster than we anticipated and almost by popular demand, as popular as open access can get, I guess, or any demand within that field can be in the humanities. We've recently established an OHP monograph project that's run in collaboration with the University of Michigan Library Scholarly Publishing Office, UC Irvine, UCLA Library, and the Public Knowledge Project headed by John Wilinski at Stanford. And the idea is to move forward both open access publishing in the humanities and the open access publishing of humanities monographs. And we're launching our monograph project with five high profile book series, as you can see. Now, the first thing that I want to say concerning the funding of open access in the humanities is that we need to recognise that the humanities have developed a very different set of professional cultures to the SDMs, who've tended to dominate the discussion around OA so far. What works in the SDMs doesn't necessarily work in the humanities, and I'm not just talking about different styles of presentation. Open access in the humanities continues to be dogged by the perception that online publication is somehow less credible than print and that it lacks rigorous standards of quality control. And this leads open access journals to being regarded as less trustworthy and desirable places to publish and as too professionally risky for early career scholars especially. But open access in the humanities is also caught uncomfortably between two stools. On the one hand, all the talk of publishing and services and platforms and tools is just that little bit too geeky for many humanities scholars. I'm sorry. On the other, compared to the likes of tactical media and mashups and internet piracy and hacktivism, open access is just too tame, too institutional, managerial and bureaucratic for many of those in the so-called digital humanities. In the humanities, the message about the importance of open access also often comes from university managers and administrators. And because there's something of a clash of ideology between managers and academics, always not perceived as being radical or cool in the way in which P2P file sharing or even open source is. And as we've heard, one of the main models of funding open access in the sciences or for peers is also not easily transferable to the humanities. Authors in the humanities are simply just not used to paying to have their work published, even if it is a matter of calling them, you know, processing or publication fees. They just associate doing so with vanity press and vanity publishing. So OHP, like most of the journals it encompasses, operates at the moment on a zero revenue, zero expenses basis. Any funding comes indirectly via our institutions paying our salaries as academics. We're simply using some of the time we're given to conduct research to create open access publishing opportunities for others. What's more, as Sigurd Jokant has pointed out, this largely volunteer effort is pretty much the norm rather than the exception when it comes to sustainable, no-fee journal publishing in many humanities fields, in both OA and non-OA sectors. Now, operating on a zero revenue, zero expenses basis like this can be a significant source of strength to many independent humanities journals and their publishers. It makes it easier for them to publish highly specialised, experimental, inter- or transdisciplinary research of the kind that John Winsky was referring to last night. Research that does not always fit into the kind of neat disciplinary categories with which for-profit publishers like to order their lists, but which nevertheless may help to push scholarship in exciting new directions. Yet it can also be a potential weakness. It opens up many such scholar-published journals to being positioned as functioning on an amateur shoestring basis, almost as cottage industries. Compared to a journal produced, say, by a large, for-profit, corporately owned press, they're far more vulnerable to being accused of being unable to sustain high academic standards in terms of their production, editing, copy editing, proofing and peer reviewing procedures. And it's precisely this perception of open access in the humanities that OHP is designed to counter. It's doing so by directly addressing these issues in order to ensure that OA publishing in certain areas of the humanities at least meets the levels of professionalism that our peers expect from publications that they associate with academic quality. Okay, so let me emphasise two points. The first is that open access, as it's been championed in the STMs, can't be simply rolled out unproblematically into the humanities, and that any attempt to do so is likely to face a number of significant challenges, as we've seen. And the second is that any attempt to develop OA in the humanities also needs to recognise that the humanities, in turn, are going to have an impact on open access. So, contrary to the impression that's given by most writing on this subject, it's not just the humanities that are going to be fundamentally transformed by this process, as by the development of OA journals and publishers such as OHP. Open access is likely to undergo a significant transformation too. For instance, to my mind, the open access movement quite simply has to place more emphasis on books. That's a picture of books, in case you've forgotten what they look like. If it doesn't, then its impact on the humanities is going to prove negligible, since it's books published with esteemed international presses, rather than articles in high-ranking journals, that are still the gold standard in many humanities fields. But the humanities also have a long tradition of exposing and subverting many of the assumptions on which OA as it's been championed in the SDMs, is based, including those associated with notions of writing, the text, the work, and even the author, to the point where the humanities and the sciences may actually be incrementable in many respects. Now, radical differences of this sort often get played down at events like this. We're all very nice and friendly and chatty. And you know, sure, we can have what Richard Poynder refers to as bad-tempered wrangles over relatively minor issues, such as metadata, copyright, and distributed versus central archives. But in the main, the emphasis in the OA movement is on presenting a more or less unified front in the face of criticism from governments and publishers and lobbyists and so forth, lest we provide them with further ammunition to attack open access, dilute our message, or otherwise distract ourselves from what we're all supposed to agree is the main task at hand, the achievement of universal free online access to research. However, I'd maintain that it's important not to see the presence of such differences and conflicts as a purely negative thing, as it might be perceived, say, by those working in the liberal tradition, with its rationalist belief in the availability of a universal consensus based on reason. In fact, if one of the impulses behind open access is to make knowledge and research, and with it society, more open and democratic, then I'd argue that the existence of such dissensus will actually help in achieving this ambition. As the political philosopher Chantal Mouffe has shown, far from placing democracy at risk, a certain degree of difference and confrontation constitutes the very possibility of its existence. So for Mouffe, a well-functioning democracy calls for a clash of legitimate democratic political positions. And speaking of metadata, this is one of the reasons why, in contrast to many in the OA community, I've elsewhere maintained that standards for preparing metadata should be generated in a plurality of different ways. Rather than adhering to the fantasy of having one single, fully integrated global archive, I'd argue instead for a multiplicity of different and at times conflicting and even incommensurable open access archives, journals, databases, and other publishing experiments. For me, the fantasy of having one place to search for scholarship and research, such as a fully integrated, indexed, and linked global archive, must remain precisely that, a totalitizing and even totalitarian fantasy. None of which is to imply that there can no longer be an OA community. It's just to acknowledge the difference and conflict of what makes a community, and indeed the common, possible. We thus need to think the nature of community, of being together, of holding something in common, a little differently. To provide you with another example of how the humanities may come to shape OA, I'd argue that the willingness of the humanities to critically interrogate many of the assumptions on which OA is based can help the OA community to avoid that fate anticipated by the philosopher Jean-Francois Lyotard. In his 1979 book, The Postmodern Condition, Lyotard contended that the widespread use of computers and databases in externalising knowledge was producing a major alteration in the status and nature of knowledge, away from questions of what is socially just and scientifically true, and toward a concern simply with optimising the system's performance. 30 years later, and a lot of OA conferences and debates are indeed taken up with showing how the externalisation of knowledge in online journals and archives can be used to make the existing system of academic research and publication much more efficient. So we have John Houghton's recent study showing that OA is actually the most cost-effective mechanism for scholarly publishing, while others have discussed at length the increases open access and related software make possible in the amount of material that can be published and stored, the number of people who can have access to it, the impact of that material, the range of distribution, the speed and ease of reporting and information retrieval, linked to what Peter Zuber called better metrics, reductions in staffing, production, reproduction costs, etc., etc. Incidentally, I'm kind of wondering if this doesn't partly explain why quite a few people associated with OR have a somewhat, well, I was going to say grumpy, but someone yesterday said dogmatic public persona. I mean, if they moralistic believe that they already know the optimum way to achieve universal open access and thus maximise the performance of the existing system of research, then presumably they can often only act negatively to correct the delays, errors and inefficiency they perceive in the ideas of others. Now, the humanities could help prevent the OA movement from becoming even more dogmatically obsessed with maximising performance, solving technical problems and eliminating efficiencies than it already is, I think. At the same time, the humanities could help the OA community to grow precisely by forcing scholars to confront issues of politics and social justice in the manner of much humanities scholarship. And doing so would be a really powerful way of encouraging more researchers in the humanities to actually publish open access. I mean, certainly few of the arguments that we currently use to persuade those in the humanities to publish OA are kind of working. It's not really been taken up very fast there. So, for example, many humanities disciplines like to think of themselves as being politically engaged. Yet the humanities also have something of a blind spot of their own when it comes to the politics of the academic publishing industries which actually make them possible, especially as those industries have become increasingly consolidated and profit-intensive in recent years. So in an article on the political economy of academic journal publishing in general and that of cultural studies in particular, Ted Striffus's provides an example of Taylor and Francis Informer. Their list features over 60 cultural studies journals, among them some of the most highly respected in the field. Yet many cultural studies scholars would be shocked to learn that one of Informer's subsidiaries was recently working for the US Army to assess how well it had achieved its goal of battlefield digitization. Which is not to say that there's something inherently immoral about the armed forces. Just that scholars may want to be critically informed about their publishers' financial links and connections, especially if those scholars are publishing research, say, criticising military intervention in Iraq or Afghanistan. I realise it's unfair, kind of unfair to single out cultural studies like this. I mean, it's not the only humanities field to have such a blind spot. What makes cultural studies' this naivety so noteworthy is the way it prides itself on being a serious political project, as Stuart Hall puts it. According to Hall, the political cultural studies intellectual has a responsibility to know more than those on the other side. And if so, then as far as Striffus is concerned, this injunction has to include knowing more about the network of social, economic, legal and infrastructural linkages to the publishing industry that sustains cultural studies and its politically engaged intellectuals and shapes and conditions that shapes the conditions in which their knowledge and research can and increasingly cannot circulate. So to this end, Striffus stresses the importance of always scratching below the surface to discover just who the corporate parents and siblings of those academic journals we're publishing are and what other activities they're involved with. Now, as someone who identifies with cultural studies to a large extent, it's long seemed significant to me that cultural studies intellectuals, who are otherwise pretty keen to wear their political commitment on their sleeves, are noticeably less keen when it comes to interrogating their own political institutional practices. And the relative lack of interest the majority of the field have shown in making their own research available away is a case in point. And certainly I think highlighting the politics of their publishing practices would be an effective way of persuading many in the humanities to engage with open access. For one thing, it'd mean OA wouldn't appear quite so tame, quite so institutional, managerial and bureaucratic. For another, scratching below the surface like this would offer an additional means of tackling the problem whereby scholar-published journals, operating independently of the profit-intensive conglomerates, are often regarded in the humanities at least as less desirable places to publish. We've already seen how OHP is specifically designed to address this issue. But could we not level the playing field even further simply by asking where the money is coming from to fund the more professionally run, so-called professionally run, journals? Would doing so not have the effect of turning the very financial independence of many small-scale journal publishers from a potential weakness into a source of strength and credibility? Not least because it means they're far less likely to be owned by a publisher whose parent company is involved in activities that many scholars, if they knew about them, would not feel comfortable about continuing to donate their time and labour to support. That's why I believe, and why I've argued elsewhere, that we, as a community of academics, authors, publishers, editors, librarians and so on, should establish an initiative whereby all academic editors and publishers are asked to make freely available on an annual basis details of both their source of income and funding and all the sources of financial income pertaining to the journals that they run. Furthermore, as part of this initiative, I suggest we set up an equivalent directory to the directory here at Lund, only in this case documenting all these various sources of income, together with information as to who the owners of the different academic journals in our respective fields are, and just as importantly, their other divisions, subsidiaries, and activities. Such an open scholarship full disclosure initiative would be of great assistance, I think, in furnishing researchers in all areas with the knowledge to make responsible political decisions as to whom they wish to publish and work with. For instance, as a result of the information obtained, some scholars might take a decision not to subscribe to, publish in, edit, peer review manuscripts, or otherwise work for journals owned by multinationals involved in supporting the military, or that have extremely high library subscription charges, or that refuse to allow authors to self-archive the accepted final drafts of their articles in institutional repositories. But I also believe it will go a long way towards encouraging those in the humanities to become more aware of their interdependence as scholars on the publishing industry. And they need to become more politically involved in it, and consequently to see online journals, and OA journals especially, as attractive and desirable places to publish. At the very least, I'm convinced that such an initiative would encourage both the editors and publishers of journals and their owners to behave a little more responsibly in political terms. What's more, be capable of having an impact, even if the editors and publishers of those journals that are produced by the large international for-profit presses, they refuse to play ball and provide full disclosure themselves. A, because such an initiative would raise awareness of the politics of journal funding and ownership generally. B, because those editors and publishers would risk appearing as if they had something to hide, especially since this initiative taps into current public discourse around freedom of information and data sharing. But it also hopefully have the effect of encouraging more scholars to research where the funding of such journals comes from, who their parent companies, institutions and organisations are, and to make the results of that research widely known and easily accessible. This is a point I've made before, but it's also worth emphasising that such an initiative would not require a huge amount of time and effort. After all, Reed, Elsevier, Springer, Wiley, Blackwell and Informer publish about, the conservative estimate is about 6,000 journals between them. So to cover 6,000 journals, or again, conservative estimate is somewhere between a quarter and a fifth of all peer-reviewed journals, you only need to research and disclose the details of four corporations. Thanks very much.
Questions?
Can I just get my book and go?
Yeah.
I didn't mean it. You can ask questions if you want.
Give them a chance, they won't ask.
Oh, there we go. There we go.
It's all right.
The joy of sex is what I always wanted.
So thanks for a really provocative talk, and I'm going to be perhaps grumpy and dogmatic, because I don't think it's actually ignoble to try and strive for getting a more efficient system than we have at the moment. You gave a long list of things increasing the efficiency with which we measure the effectiveness of research, increasing the effectiveness in which we do research, increasing the range in which we give access to information to people. You listed them all. I don't think that's a bad thing. And you sort of tend, maybe I'm paraphrasing you in the wrong way, but I don't necessarily think that's, as I say, an ignoble thing to be striving for.
Yeah, you're paraphrasing me in the wrong way. I didn't say it was an ignoble thing. I was saying, is that, as John Wilinski was saying last night, is that the main purpose of what we're doing? Is that the ultimate goal of putting all this stuff online? I mean, is that what we want to do? We just want to put it all online and make it available, and then we can all go home kind of happy? Is that it? Or are there other things as well? So it's kind of just, you know, why are we doing it? It's a basic thing, other than, is that the goal in itself? And just to think about that, I suppose, to ask that question.
I suppose, in a way, the answer to that is actually encapsulated in the Budapest Open Access Initiative, because Peter can quote it much better than I can because he wrote it. But it says that, you know, the aim is to be able to do things with the information. It's not just to put it there. It is to reuse it, to repurpose it, to do exciting things with it. I don't think there are many people in the OA movement, again, being grumpy and dogmatic, I don't think there's many people in the OA movement who actually think that that is the end in itself. I think most of us realise that that's actually just the starting point. That's actually where the most exciting stuff gets to. And we're actually a bit tired of the fact that it's taking so long to get to the starting line.
Yeah, I'm tired of it as well. I mean, I work putting this stuff up there and making it available as well. I suppose I'm just, do we have to wait until that point before we start doing something interesting? And it's not an either or, and I'm not saying that we don't do interesting things. It's just, sometimes when I come to events, when I read this stuff, it's, you know, I'm seeing there's a difference in emphasis. And sometimes for me, the emphasis is too much on that other side.
Are there any other questions?
More comment than a question, just picking up on exactly what you said. The emphasis is very often determined by the audience it's aimed at. And very often, open access advocates are aiming at senior policymakers in institutions as well as in funding organisations and so on. And you've got to press buttons to do with efficiency and delivering value and all of that kind of thing. And that's probably why the emphasis is placed there. But most OA advocates probably have something deeper than that in terms of their own personal perspective. So whilst it may not appeal to many humanities scholars, and I agree, those kind of arguments don't, it may be because most arguments in favour of OA have not been aimed at humanities scholars to date. So what we've got to do is think about what presses the right buttons for that audience, because there will be, as you point out, buttons that you need to press. But to date, it's been aimed at government, funders, that kind of thing, and so that's where the emphasis has lain. So it may not necessarily characterise the advocates' views themselves, just what they're trying to do and the audiences they're trying to reach.
Sure, I agree. It's you're making strategic decisions, and we make strategic decisions around, you know, with OHP and all that kind of advocacy. Yeah, I support that. It's just, if you want to move it into the humanities, if you want more people to join it, then you're going to, as you say, have to reach different audiences. And that works with a certain audience. Now, I would say that that's quite a dominant message within OA, and it might be perfectly good strategic reasons for that, but I'm just raising some questions that people might want to think about.
Is there anyone else? All right, then.
please join me in thanking you very much again.
Thank you.